David Rotrammel. She is survived by a daughter-in-law, Deanna Rotrammel, the widow of Merle David of Yukon, Oklahoma, a son, Julian Rotrammel, and his wife, Brenda of Lenexa, Kansas, son, Garth Rotrammel, and wife, Connie of Fayetteville, daughter, Rachel, and her husband, Kenny Ford of Ridgecrest, California, grandson, John Rotrammel, and his wife, Victoria of Houston, Texas, granddaughter, Jenna, and her husband, Wes Stacy of Fayetteville, grandson Jeremiah, grandson Daniel, sister Jeanette and her husband Jack Sams of Berryville, brother Joe Perkins and his wife Sheila of Berryville, Arkansas, and sister Brenda and her husband G.P. Richardson of Green Forest, and two great-grandchildren, Gabriel and Eli Rumbo, as well as a number of nieces and nephews and a host of beloved friends that she has made over the years and whose lives she certainly brightened. Now, those are facts and figures and dates, and they do not do justice to Betty Rotrammel. You cannot summarize a life with those kind of statistics. And so hopefully, over the course of the remainder of this service, we'll all get to remember her a little bit more personally, a little better, and we'll all leave this place enriched by the life that we enjoyed for those many, many years. Would you join me in prayer as we dedicate this time to God? Lord, we are so thankful and we are so grateful for the life of one Betty Rotrammel. Lord, for many in this room, they lived out their entire lives, sharing their life with her. And Lord, I pray today your special touch and your special grace on their lives. I pray that they would recognize the glory of God in her life as it was lived out in front of all of us. Lord, I pray that they would find means to celebrate on this day, even though their hearts are grieving, that they would recognize the reality of Betty Rotrammel's existence now, that they would understand how wonderful her life is and how God has provided for her in a special way. And Lord, I pray today that you would provide for each of us. For those who grieve, I pray that your grace would be sufficient. And for those today who may feel like they just cannot get past this moment, that you would come alongside them as you have promised to do, and that you would lift them up and love them and encourage them, Lord, as only you can do. And so, Lord, in this hour, we look to you for grace, and we claim the promise that that is what you intend to do for all of us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Day, oh happy day, when Jesus washed my sins away. Oh happy day, oh happy day, when Jesus washed my sins away. He taught me how to watch and pray and live rejoicing every day. Oh, happy day. Oh, happy day, when Jesus washed my sins away. When Jesus washed my sins away.
Allow me to read an excerpt from Betty's last personal letter that she wrote on September 9th, just a month before she passed away. Some of you in this room received a copy of that letter. Well, I will acknowledge at 84 years old, I know my time is pretty short on this earth. I am more mindful of that as the days go by, and I was just talking about the fact I really don't fear dying. Of course, the only reason I can say that is because of Jesus. I know if death came apart from his finished work, providing my righteousness, my salvation, I would need to fear. But as it is, I am trusting in the reality that he has satisfied the penalty for my sin, which was death. Our pastor has been preaching on a series on classic truths over the summer. I wasn't able to attend every week, but how important for people to understand it is not about our being good, but all about his goodness and provision on our behalf. So while I'm mindful of the shortness of time, I can move ahead without fear. In Romans chapter 11, we find the Apostle Paul overwhelmed in considering God's sovereign purpose in bringing all peoples, Jews and Gentiles alike, into his glorious salvation. We read, "Oh, the depth of the riches of the wisdom and knowledge of God! How unsearchable his judgments and his paths beyond tracing out! Who has known the mind of the Lord? Or who has been his counselor? Who has ever given to God that God should repay them? For from him and through him and for him are all things. To him be the glory forever. Amen."
Let's sing together. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him. Christ the Lord. When the is called up yonder, when the roll is called up yonder, when the roll is called up yonder, when the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there.
Good afternoon. I want to again thank everyone for coming and thank everyone here at Southern Heights for the love and prayers and thoughts that have been directed to Betty's family and friends over the last few weeks and the last few days. Reverend Moore, we haven't had a chance to have an extensive visit, but we have had a chance to meet, and I want to thank you. Any pastor that pastors this church, I consider as my personal pastor, because as those of you who know me know, Berryville is my spiritual home, and I rededicated my life right here in this town. This church wasn't here then, but the people remain, and they're God's people, whatever church that they're in. So I have the unenviable task, as Reverend Moore noted in his opening, of summarizing the life of Betty Sue Perkins Rotrammel, who probably the worst kept secret in town is that she was my dearest friend for a little over 30 years, which, just for those of you who do arithmetic, that's over a third of her life and over half of mine. I want to start first with a scripture which I find particularly comforting and meaningful at this time, from the book of John, chapter 14, verses 1 through 3. Jesus, right before the end of his life, is speaking to his apostles. This is at the time of the Last Supper. And he says, "Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go to prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye may be also." Betty believed in that promise, and on the afternoon of October 10th, he came for her. As I mentioned before, Betty was probably my dearest friend. She had a number of nicknames, but she was only Morticia to one person, and that would be me. She is in a better place today. I miss her terribly. I have thought since the 10th of October of half a dozen things. Next time we talk, I need to be sure and mention this, or be sure to ask about, because we communicated frequently over the 31 years that we knew each other, even though I haven't actually lived here in Berryville since about 1990. The last time I talked with her was the Sunday before she passed. We had gotten into kind of a routine. Every couple of weeks on Sunday we would talk. Either I would call her, she would call me. We would talk for toward the end as long as her strength held out. And she would very often say, especially the last year and a half, "This may be the last time we talk." And I finally had to say, "Quit saying that. Let's enjoy the time we have. Let's not, one of these days, you will be right. But I hope it's not today." Well, the Sunday before she passed, she didn't say that. And that was the last time we talked. I'd tell you that we had a brilliant conversation, but actually it was a pretty ordinary, run-of-the-mill conversation. She asked how my family was. I asked how her family was. I asked had she heard anything from anybody in Berryville that we both knew. We talked about 15 minutes, and she said, "I love you," and I said, "I love you too," and then we said goodbye. When Garth called Tuesday afternoon, I knew the minute, as so many of you did when you got Garth's call, we all knew what the message was going to be. And I have since learned that she got her last wish. She went almost instantly at the end. And I like to think, and I'm going to get a chance to ask one of these days, but I'm going to have to wait for a bit. I like to think she closed her eyes here and opened them in heaven above. Yeah. And I'm certain that she's there, and I'm certain that she's watching, and I'm certain that she's saying, "Remember what I told you, don't go too long. These people have lives to live." So after I talked to Garth on that Tuesday, I started pulling this together. She said back when I lived here, I'd known her and Bill about 3 years, she said, "You are doing my eulogy at my funeral." I said, "Not this week." I said, "And probably not for a long time." She said, "I don't care, you're doing it, and here's some things I want you to say." So from then on, every once and again through the years, put this in the eulogy file, put this in the eulogy file. So I started pulling things together, and then she said, "Keep it to 10 minutes. I said, "It's not possible." I said, "I will aim for about twice that, and I may miss that a little, but I promise you it won't be too long." She said, "It better not be." So I'm kind of under the gun here. But one of the interesting things as I begun to pull this together, there's a particular way that this body that I'm in responds to grief. And one of the first things, especially when someone close to me passes, the first thing I start with is a huge, monstrous headache. It usually takes a day, day and a half to pass. And I was getting ready for the headache, and all of a sudden I'm sitting there making a few notes, and all of a sudden I get this impression. It says, it's not words I can see, it's not a visual, it's just a sense, an intuition, a sensation, whatever you want to call it. 4 words that came in groups of two. The first two-word group was, "I'm here." The second two-word group was, "I'm free." Followed by a flood of just pure, unalloyed joy. I've never experienced joy like that. And hey, I was not feeling joyful at that point. No possible way. Instantly, my headache cleared up. And for those of you who know Betty really well, she always took pride that she never cried when people passed. I haven't shed tear one. I don't know what to make of that. I don't understand metaphysics. I'm really very skeptical about stuff like that. I figure when it's my turn and when I get the promise of the knowledge that we're all promised when we get to heaven, I figure I'll understand it then. So I'm not going to interpret anything much except to say when Betty was younger, before the Parkinson's kicked in, we had an ability to know when each of us was hurting or when something disastrous had happened. I recall a time back in, I think it was around 1987, Dina, you'll remember this. I was sitting in my office downtown Berryville doing what lawyers do, making life better for everyone. Well, okay. And all of a sudden, I just felt like I have to call Betty, there's something wrong. And I called, and she was shattered. She had just received news that Merle was desperately ill in Oklahoma and was having to have major surgery. His Crohn's had gotten out of hand. And I said, well, is there anything I can do? She said, yes, pray. I said, well, obviously, yes, we're going to do that. I said, is there anything else you need? She said, I can't think right now. We're throwing everything in the car and we're headed for Oklahoma City. I said, okay, just be careful. I said, I think it's probably going to be okay. I said, Merle's in good hands. He's a strong, healthy man, reasonably. And there's no reason to think he won't tolerate this procedure. She said, well, thank you, and hung up, and they went, and of course, Merle healed, and she said, it was your, he's going to be okay. It's all I had in my locker. That's the only shot I had. I took it, and I'm so delighted that on that occasion I was right. I sure would have hated to have not been. But there was another time in 1997, I was living in Los Angeles, and all of a sudden the phone rang about the middle of the morning. And Betty said, I just called, there's something wrong. Tell me what's wrong. I said, well, as a matter of fact, there is. My brother-in-law had been run over that morning and killed. She said, I just felt that something was not right, and I just had to call and touch base. I said, well, I'm glad you did, and I told her what had happened. And there were other instances of that in the time we knew each other, up until the point at which her Parkinson's kicked in. That's one of the first things that Parkinson's took from us, was the ability we had to sense when something was not wrong. And I'm thinking that God's grace and mercy allowed us one last sensation so that I wouldn't be concerned, so that I can convey to you, she's there. Yeah. And she's free of the beast known as Parkinson's. And she's whole again. I don't know if that's the emotional side of my brain kicking in and giving it to me. I don't think so, but you're free to judge that for what it is. Betty had a lifelong love of the Lord. The pastor's already referred to it in a letter, and I was so afraid, Pastor, you were going to pick the letter that I had. You didn't. So I'm going to share something from a letter she wrote back in 2009. Incidentally, some of you know every year she did at least one scrapbook for me. I counted the other day and I lost count after 42. So a lot of this stuff, in addition to the eulogy folder, I had more material than anybody should ever have to try to winnow through to get to a short presentation today. But she wrote in 2009, she said, I can't remember not knowing about Jesus as he was presented at home in church by my mother through songs and Bible stories. I remember my dad singing as he plowed. I followed him barefooted, enjoying the soft dirt on my feet. He sang old hymns like, will work till Jesus comes. There's an all-seeing eye watching you. Will there be any stars in my crown? And of course, the old rugged cross. Betty, to call Betty an activist Christian doesn't begin to cover the turf. She was a Sunday school teacher. Especially when I knew her, she taught generations of Berryville 4- and 5-year-olds on Sunday. She was in the choir. Every church potluck, she brought enough to feed a small army. Of course, as the pastor noted, her and Bill's 28 years in the Great Passion Play, which was a phenomenal ministry. This woman meant something. And she did not waste her time here with us. She went out and she touched lives. She loved her family. You can tell from the letters that have been written. She loved her parents. She loved her siblings. She was the oldest. And she said that meant I had to take care of all the rest of them. Now, she did not tell me this, but back when I lived here, of course, Berryville being a small community, most everybody stays here, and I knew some people who had been in elementary school with Betty who said she was the terror of the playground. You didn't mess with the Perkins kids, because if any of them got hurt, they had to fight Betty, and Betty knew how. So she was fiercely loyal to her family, fiercely loyal to Bill, who was the love of her life. I think the pastor said that too. He's the only one who made her eyes light up. Well, okay, there was perhaps one other, but Kirk Douglas doesn't know where Berryville is. Those of you who remember back in the day, we used to show The Villain, starring Kirk Douglas, multiple times a year. That was for Betty's benefit, and that was her other guy. Her kids, Merle, Julian, Garth, Rachel, the grandkids, and now the great-grandkids, she loved you all. She used to tell on all of you. You may think you have secrets. I got them all. Yeah. And that's okay, because I ain't going to tell anybody. So she really cared about family. She cared about her friends. Now, it has been said by other people that I'm probably her best and dearest friend. I can live with that. Yeah. I think that's probably true, basically for one thing. And it's a very simple phrase. People have said, why don't you get married? Bill's gone now. She wants to get married again. Why don't you marry her? I couldn't. She couldn't. We are so close, and our brains work so much in the same way, although our interests are widely divergent. Our thought processes are so much the same, it'd be like marrying yourself. And that's just not in the cards. But the secret to our relationship, and I hope everybody has somebody in their life that they can say this about, is we understood each other. Four simple little words. We understood each other. That means we understood when an eyebrow went up, when a nerve here in the cheek twitched, when there was a hand movement, when there was words coming out of the mouth. We didn't understand always the words, but we understood what was the feeling behind the words. In short, we couldn't hide from each other. And if we weren't happy with each other, which didn't happen that often, we had to be very careful, because we knew if we hurt each other, we were hurting ourselves at the same time. We would feel it as much as the other person in the relationship. Everybody deserves a friend like that. And I don't know how I'm going to get along without my friend for a while, but she left me the gift, and I'm hanging on to it tight with both hands. We could finish each other's sentences until the Parkinson's got in the way. I told you the last time we talked. Let me tell you about the first time I saw her. Some of you have heard this story before at least 24 times, but it's a good story. I was in practice here in April of 1986 when the Carroll County Cattlemen's Association came up with a new thing called the Super Cow Clinic. They were bringing in equipment, feed experts for the cattle industry here in Carroll County, and as part of the deal, they were having a barbecue dinner and beans, and I did and still do like to eat. And it was also an opportunity to get out and meet people, and I was still new here, and you know. So I went to the Super Cow Clinic. The barbecue there was great. I went every time I could go until they quit having them in 2009, and I greatly regret that it's not here anymore because the barbecue there was terrific. But on this particular day, I was going through the line, and here was this little woman in a red embroidered Indian style dress with lots of turquoise rocks on. And she was dipping out ham and beans to go with the barbecue. I got my plate, introduced myself, went on through the line, and found me a shade tree there in the parking lot of Cattleman's Restaurant there in Green Forest, and started eating my lunch and visiting with some people I knew. And I'm watching. She's got something on her mind. I don't know what it is, and it doesn't involve me, but here comes the guest of honor through the line. The governor of the state of Arkansas had come because it's an election year. If you're running for office, you go where the people are, and this was a quasi-political event. So here's Bill Clinton coming through the line, and here's Betty. Now, there were times when Betty was a Bill Clinton fan. There were times she was not a Bill Clinton fan. And in 1986 was one of the years she was not a Bill Clinton fan. So here's the governor of the state of Arkansas coming through the line. And along the ham and bean tray, if you've ever dipped ham and beans, you know the bean stuff accumulates. A little crust forms on, okay. She has very deliberately taken her hand, her right hand, and run it along the edge of that ham and bean tray and gotten ham and bean crust. And I'm like, oh, I think we're about to have an event. So I'm looking here, and Bill's going down the line doing what politicians do, shaking hands, nice to see you. Of course, Bill has been told that all of these are local politicals or connections with local politicals, and so he's especially not going to do anything that would be untoward. He gets to Betty, and she stares at him with those big blue eyes, totally vacant, and holds out her hand. And she smiles sweetly with a stare that says, I got space for rent up here and lots of it. And he looks, and I'm thinking, I'm about to get a lesson on how politicians handle things like this. He took a deep breath, reached out his hands, took it, shook it, dropped it, down the line he went. So the next thing I know, his car is pulled up just right across the parking lot from where I am. And his security guy's over there, and Bill's doing this. He said, give me a handkerchief. His security officer said, I'm sorry, Governor, what? Get me a handkerchief. I don't understand, Governor. That crazy old lady put bean juice in my hands. I need a handkerchief. Of course, it was also funny. I had to actually move from the parking lot because I was in his line of vision, and I was having a real hard time resisting throwing myself on the ground and rolling over and over laughing uncontrollably. That's the first time I saw Betty, but we really didn't get to know each other then. I decided, some friends talked me into giving the passion play a try. So I went out for the passion play that year, and here was her and Bill during signups at the passion play, and I'm like, ooh. The crazy old lady who gave Bill Clinton a handful of beans is on this side of the room. I'm going that side over there. I did. Come the first night of the passion play, they're dividing us up into our cast rooms. I walk into my cast room, and here's the crazy old lady on the other side of the counter. Hi, my name's Betty Rowtrammel. I'm your wardrober. I took her hand. I looked at it. I shook it. Hi, I'm Philip Gould. And she did the usual what do you do, where are you from, who do you know, all the things you say when you're getting acquainted. It took about a week, and we figured out that one of two things had to happen. We realized we couldn't hide from each other. And when you get those people in your life, you either have to stay very close or you have to get away. Yeah. And neither one of us wanted to get away. So here I am 31 years later. Yeah. We had a lot of fun at the Passion Play. We had a lot of fun. Whatever we did, we probably scarred at least one generation of Berryville young people with some of the shenanigans we pulled. But I think they're probably better for it. All of the organizations that the pastor listed that she was a part of, the Passion Play, the Friends of the Library, the Church, NARFI, the Daughters of the American Revolution, the Art Guild, and there are probably a couple dozen more that I don't even remember, she and Bill were on the go constantly. And it was through her that I largely came to know many people here. I knew several in my work as city attorney and as a practicing attorney here in town. But there were people I would never have met and gotten to know except for her, and I'm grateful for that. The scrapbooks to me, the 42 scrapbooks, the ones from when I lived here are the only records I have from my years here. I didn't keep my own newspaper clippings, but I've got them thanks to her. Some people say you shouldn't have humor in a eulogy, that a funeral is a serious business. Betty said, make them laugh. She was not one for every social convention that came down the pike. And if she could leave an original memory in somebody's head and make them feel better about themselves and about their life, that's what she went for. And if she had to appear like a crazy old lady in doing that, she wasn't above it. I'm a little like that myself, but I don't want that to get out. In the scrapbooks, I looked for some humor that might be appropriate for this situation. I didn't find it, but here's what I found. She, in the 2003 scrapbook, she had a story about Billy Graham. And Billy Graham had come home from one of his crusades to Charlotte, and he was picked up at the airport by a limousine to be taken home. And Reverend Graham said to the driver, to his chauffeur, he said, you know, he said, I'm 87 years old. He said, I've been doing this for decades. He said, I have never gotten a chance to drive a limousine. Would you mind riding in the back and let me drive the limo home, and then I'll get out and everything will be fine? And the limo driver said, well, if you're sure you can handle it, he said, I'd like to try. If I get in trouble, I promise I'll pull over. So the limo driver said, okay. Well, he's going 57 miles an hour, and there's a new deputy sheriff on the road between the airport and Billy Graham's house running a new speed trap. So he sees the car coming through at 57 miles an hour. Here come the blue lights, pulls over the limo. Billy Graham rolls down the driver's side window. The sheriff's deputy sees who it is, does a double take, and says, I'll be right back. Goes back to the car, radios for his superior officer. Said, look, I'm new at this. I know I'm supposed to enforce the law, and I've got this car 57 in the 55 mile an hour speed zone. But I also know that sometimes with important people, we cut them a little slack. The supervisor said, well, yeah, that's true. Who you got, the governor? He said, no, I think it's somebody way more important than the governor. The supervisor said, the president? No, somebody more important than the president. Well, who do you think it is? He said, well, I think it's probably Jesus, because Billy Graham is his chauffeur. I thought about doing some slides for today from things in the scrapbooks. She always used to include some nude pictures. I mean, she was an artist, and artists tend to think there's beauty in everything, perhaps sometimes when maybe things are better left covered. But, you know, all those pictures of cows and pigs and chickens never bothered me. But they were always included with a note, please don't tell anybody I included these nude pictures in your scrapbook. And there was always snake stuff. Articles, pictures, drawings. I hate snakes. The only good snake is a dead snake. And some of you out there are agreeing with me. I see some heads nodding. Betty loved them. Just think of all the wheat that would be that wouldn't be available for human beings to eat if there weren't snakes to eat the rats that get in the wheat bins. Well, I had to admit the logic of it, but that doesn't mean I was going to ever approve of a snake. But there was always snake stuff. That's one of those occasions where no matter how similar or how alike we were, we had some radically different ideas. She always used to include recipes. She did cookbooks. I was fortunate to be able to help her with the very first one. And by my count, she did six, plus at least one book of cartoons. But I may be off one or two. And she did them not just for her and Bill. She and Bill did two. She did one for the Passion Play. She did at least three, and I think maybe four for the Carroll County Library. Once again, sharing, reaching out, helping other people besides herself. But and as a result of her love for cooking and my love for cooking, she always used to include recipes. But I have to say, I generally didn't try them. Stuffed cow's udder and boiled sow's ears just don't do it for me. And I promise you, I couldn't make that up. They're in the scrapbooks. She used to write stories. One of her favorites she put in a scrapbook back in 1998 about Lester and Kester, two little mice, and their mother's 210,000th litter. And of course, the obligatory cartoons, drawings, and everything else. Betty always was concerned about other people. She was always concerned about making them feel better. Even the staffs of the homes that she was in when she could no longer live independently. She made an impression wherever she was, and she didn't really care how she did it. But it was always a good impression, and the world is a much poorer place because she's not with us anymore. Well, let's see. My three points were she loved God, she loved her family, she loved friends in her life. So that's my three points. I guess all that's left is the poem. And this came from a scrapbook that she put together for me back in 1994. It's entitled To an Old Friend by Ann Campbell. Out of the sunny past you came, calling me by my childhood name, bringing me meadows rich with wheat, the sheltered lane, and the cool retreat. Out of the land of used to be, smiling, you gave your hand to me. Under your spell I saw once more the garden gate and the farmhouse door. Once, in a distant glowing time, shoulder to shoulder we used to climb. Green was the hill and the path curved high to the turquoise arc of the friendly sky. Gone is the farmhouse and gone the grove. Gone are the landmarks we used to love. Gone is our footprint on the hill. Only our friendship lingers still. Au revoir, Matisha. Je t'adore.
for me. surveyed all the good things that come to me from above. If I count all the blessings from the storehouse of love, I'd simply ask for a favor of him beyond mortal king, and I'm sure that he'd grant it again. I want to stroll over heaven with you some glad day, when all our troubles and heartaches are vanished away. Then we'll enjoy the beauty where all things are new. I want to stroll over heaven with you. Places of beauty we long to see here below, but time and treasures have kept us from making plans, as you know. But come the morning of the rapture, together we'll stand anew. While I stroll over heaven with you, I want to stroll over heaven with you some glad day, when all our troubles and heartaches are vanished away. Then we'll enjoy the beauty where all things are new. I want to stroll over heaven with you. I want to stroll over heaven with you.
And left to die. Oh, raise your head, for love is passing by. Come to Jesus, come to Jesus, come to Jesus and live. Now your burden's lifted and carried far away, and precious blood has washed away the stain. So sing to Jesus, sing to Jesus, sing to Jesus and live. And like a newborn baby, don't be afraid to crawl. And remember, when you walk, sometimes we fall. So fall on Jesus, fall on Jesus, fall on Jesus and live. Sometimes the way lonely and steep and filled with pain. So if your sky is dark and pours the rain, then cry to Jesus, cry to Jesus, cry to Jesus music fills the night. And when you can't contain your joy inside, then dance for Jesus. Dance for Jesus. Dance for Jesus. Your final heartbeat, kiss the world goodbye, then go in peace and laugh on glory's side, and fly to Jesus, fly to Jesus, fly to Jesus. Jesus, fly to Jesus and
live. We'll just do it once for now, but we'll play it over and over later. Okay. All right. My brother is coming with reflections. You Yeah. Well, I am Jeanette, in case you didn't notice. If I mess this up, you talk about pressure. Jeanette's going to kill me, and you'll be doing my funeral, so. So this is actually Jeanette. Dear sister, I was heartbroken when Garth called to say you'd left us. But when I woke the next morning, God spoke to me. He let me know that you were there with him, Bill, your husband, your son Merle, your parents, and many more loved ones. You no longer had Parkinson's, and you were with your loved ones. You got your wish to go on to heaven. I know you are enjoying entertaining everyone. I wonder what costume you have on. You were a very giving person. So many people are telling me how you taught their children in Sunday school, and how you went the extra mile for the kids. Some of them are grown now, but they still love that little something special. You were one of a kind. I wasn't always sure what you were going to do or say. I remember the time at Freeman Heights we were practicing for our cantata. The director said for us to wear a little tie when we were doing the program. You spoke up and said, "I'm not. I don't like wearing them." The lady sitting next to me said, "Who does she think she is talking like that? That really ticks me off." I let her speak a few more words and then I said, "That's my sister." Talk about someone wanting to fall in a hole and never come out. You raised four wonderful children. They loved you dearly. You had two angels looking after you when you went to assisted living, your son Garth and his wife Connie. They were there for you every day. They took you to church, out to eat, and shopping. You will be missed by all of us. We have many memories of you. Some are pretty funny, but that was you. By the way, I know how you loved Rayma. Rayma, where are you at? Up there she is. Well, she typed this letter for me. Yes, yes, I did tell her thank you. Goodbye for now, sis. We'll meet you in heaven someday soon.
So on the morning that Mom passed away, I walked in her room and she was busy I didn't need these when Dad passed away 9 years ago. They're just for reading. But I walked in her room, and she was busy scratching away letters with pictures and stuff, as she always did. A few days later, I went and checked her desk because I could see she was busy that day. And I actually have letters that were written to some of you in this place. So I'm just going to tell you. I want to see some of you after because I actually have mail for you that didn't make it yet. Okay. I want to read about Mom because the last part of Mom's life, particularly since 2013, Connie and I had the opportunity to live in Fayetteville where Mom lived. And so that gave us the opportunity to see day-to-day interactions. And so we got to observe a lot of things that Mom was walking through. And I want to share three of those things in the context of her spiritual life over those years. As God's people, we're blessed to have His Word. It's full of timeless truth, which can be applied to every issue that we face in this life. So, I was observing in my mom's life, and I want to share these three things with this challenge, and that is this. If God's Word is true, if it's suitable for framing every issue we face in this life, then surely it should affect how we live day by day, right? The first one is this, Romans 8, 18 to 23 in particular, where Paul writes, "Our present sufferings are not worth comparing with the glory that will be revealed in us. We ourselves who have the first fruits of the Spirit groan inwardly as we wait eagerly for our adoption into sonship and the redemption of our bodies." Mom was a fighter. She was an overcomer, and she lived with Parkinson's diagnosis for about 30 years. For the first two decades, she absolutely refused to be defined by Parkinson's, right? She referred to it as Parkinson's tendencies, right? Dr. Bell, her family physician, said to me one time when I was there, "You know, when it comes to Parkinson's, denial seems to work pretty well for your mom." And it did. It's probably not the best approach to life to live in denial. My wife tells me that a lot, and that's a good thing. All right. Ultimately, there was no denying the loss of mobility and fine motor skills, which eventually precipitated her move to assisted living in Fayetteville in 2013. But you saw from the video, she continued to persevere. It did not hold her back, right? So she was always hopeful for a cure and being healed of Parkinson's even. But in the absence of that, the disease served as a reminder of this truth found in Romans 8, and that is that sin entered the world and subjected the whole creation to death, decay, and destruction. But Romans 8:21 makes it clear that all of this was allowed to happen in what? The certain hope that the creation itself will be liberated from its bondage to decay and brought into the freedom and the glory of the children of God. Mom was ready for this liberation. "I'm here. I'm free." The second is 1 Corinthians 13. Love is patient. Love is kind. It does not envy. It does not boast. It is not proud. It does not dishonor others. It is not self-seeking. It is not easily angered. Love keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, and always perseveres. And that's the second area. I personally observed as Mom worked through earthly relationships, all right? Now, Mom was capable of demonstrating a quick temper or even holding a grudge if she deemed someone's actions as unfavorable or unkind, right? Any of the cousins who were around when we were younger will recall Mom reaching up, her hand functioning like a periscope, looking for the old blue belt on top of the refrigerator. Indeed, judgment could be swift, whether it was just or not. Later in life, she would laugh about that. Oh, yeah. Actually, what did she laugh about? She laughed because I was able to evade that swift judgment by just jumping up and evading the belt. But the real point is that Mom acknowledged her natural inclination toward quick temper or a grudge. I was personally involved in conversations with her about God's word clearly states about love. I witnessed her sincerely purposing responses that were guided by love. And that's in obedience to what God said, right? Now, admittedly, sometimes it came in stages. One day I walked into her apartment. She had been carrying one of those grudging attitudes toward one of the nurses that offended her kind of at the outset. She said to me, "Well, you'll be glad to know. I think I'm turning the corner with the old battle axe." Can you hear it? So. But again, what I witnessed with Mom was what I believe a true desire to demonstrate love, to be a peacemaker, and she did so regardless of what anyone else would say or think about it. She chose to act in love, and that allowed her to live as a person freed from the bondage of unforgiveness, which quite frankly is self-imposed in our lives. The last one is 1 John 5:13. "I write these things to you," said John, "so that you may know that you have eternal life." And so when Mom moved over to Fayetteville and brought the opportunity for her attend church every week, Connie would pick Mom up before church. We'd all go to lunch together, typically after church. And then I'd take Mom back to the facility and tuck her in for her afternoon nap before Julian called. Kind of, usually. Maybe Philip. On one particular day, the pastor had been preaching a series of messages from 1 John, and Mom commented on how thankful she was for this as she was thinking about the characteristics of having the Holy Spirit in her, encouraging us to love those in God's church, wanting to be around His people, His church. The Holy Spirit convincing us of sin, judgment, and truth. All of these were evidence of His work in our lives, pointing us toward this knowing that we have eternal life. And so I'm very thankful, very appreciative of having had the opportunity to be up close and personal in the context of providing evidence that points to a person whose life was indeed being shaped and molded by God Himself, as one being conformed to the image of His Son, Jesus, day by day. Yeah.
Jeanette, I should make you come up here and read mine for me. That was just brutal. Thank you very much. Everybody's with me and against Jeanette, raise your hand. Yeah, look at all those hands. My mom hated me going on mission trips. I was always going to a dangerous country. It didn't matter where I was going. I said I could go to Fort Knox and sit in there for a week. It'd be a dangerous country.
Yeah.
I was in Honduras when she passed. I said, "Mom, I'll be at a national police academy with 2,000 police officers." And she thought about it for a while. She's pondering this. I said, "It'll be safe." She goes, "You think it'll be safe?" I said, "Yeah, it'll be safe." She goes, "Well, will they have guns?" I said, "Well, yeah, I think there'll be about 2,000 guns there, as a matter of fact." But thankfully, my phone didn't work in Honduras, but she called me on the Saturday before she passed, and it worked. And I got to say goodbye, you know, just that short, sweet conversation. So it was pretty cool. A couple of stories. I remember sitting in church humming. One time I was bored. It wasn't you preaching, I know, but I was bored and entertaining myself, and she says, "Knock it off." So I stopped for a minute, and I started in again. She goes, "Knock it off or else." I said, "Or else what?" She goes, "I'll take you outside, and you know what else." Well, stupid as I was, I started in again, and bam, I was like Superman. My feet didn't touch the floor. I flew outside, flew down the hallway, bam, 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 brings me back in. She didn't have the blue belt, but it didn't matter. Let's see here. I can't forget the time Mom decided that I needed to start wearing Merle's hand-me-down jeans, and he's an inch or two shorter than me, and they were definitely high-water pants. And I complained about it, and she goes, "Well, they just need a little bit of ironing." I said, "They need more than ironing." And she reached up there for the fly swatter, and she didn't get it, thankfully. I see cousins here that have been attacked by the fly swatter, know all about it. But I was so grateful for the time I finally had enough money to go over here to Carr's Dry Goods and get my own pair of Levi's. Mom was always saying she was going to go fill in the blank and give someone a piece of her mind. And one day she was going in to talk to the school administrators and give them a piece of her mind because some sibling had lost their track suit and it was going to cost $5 or $8, I think. Man, she got fired up, roared into town, jumped on the school administrator, and no one paid any $5 that day. Mom was a good listener. When I was about 12 years old, a couple of neighbor boys in Oklahoma City announced they were going to Woodstock, and it was going to be colossal, and I should go along with them. I was enthralled that the older guys would want me to go hang out with them and drive to Woodstock, wherever that was. And I'd saved up $8 to spend on gas and food. I guess we was going to eat at McDonald's, huh, Glenn? My dad would have said, "You're crazy." My mom listened patiently and convinced me otherwise, that I probably shouldn't go there. And I'm eternally grateful I didn't go. A lot of other memories, but you can't miss out when you talk about Betty Sue. You can talk about jewelry and clothes and parties and practical jokes. Her faith, her family, her church family. Jewelry, as you saw in the pictures, and y'all remember this, she not only had a lot of jewelry, she had a lot at home that you didn't see, that didn't get in the rotation. Some of it was colossally huge, a ring that's bigger than my hand. But as much as she liked it, she'd also give it away. She was a giver that way. I didn't get any of it, but I didn't want any of it. Clothes. Mom had tons and tons of clothes. When we moved her to assisted living, I thought we was going to have to add on to the closet. And you know, a lot of her clothes weren't very subtle either, but both her clothing and her jewelry was a statement of her big, outgoing personality. It embarrassed us no end when we were teenagers, but that was just her. And Philip, thanks a lot. You stole part of my speech. I had a whole thing on the blob and the thing that came to dinner or whatever, and their Halloween parties. I'll skip that. Mom was a practical joker. You remember her wearing her combat fatigues around the square and telling everybody that she'd been drafted to go to Iraq. I don't think a 70-year-old woman's going to Iraq. But back in the day, if you wanted to disrespect somebody, you'd say, "Hey, your mama wears combat boots." And I could proudly say, "Yeah, my mom wears two pairs of them. She's got them, you know, either one on or and one in the garage or closet." But and who can forget her wearing her flea market wedding gown around and telling everybody she was fixing to get married? And it was just the victim of the day that she was going to marry. Mom was a strong Christian who lived her faith daily, taught us how to love God, proud of her country. She paid good money for that Daughters of American Revolution research. And she was proud to be married to a combat veteran, Bill. She loved her church family, and many of her best friends through the years came from churches like Valley View, Freeman Heights, Southern Heights, and then finally Ridgeview. She was very loyal and loving to her family. She loved family gatherings and cooking for them. I'm especially going to miss her fruitcakes. It sounds like a joke, but they were really good. And Mom's daughter-in-law has always said that whoever was in the room alone with her, that she'd tell them, "You're my favorite daughter-in-law."
Yeah.
But she loved and spoiled them equally. Psalms 116:15 says, "Precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his faithful servant." We're so thankful for y'all coming here today and helping us celebrate the death of his faithful servant, Betty Sue. Thank you.
I've got some words you can put up. Maybe on the screen there. Yeah, there we go. "Oh soul, are you weary and troubled? No light in the darkness you see. There's light for a look at the Savior, and life more abundant and free. From death into life everlasting, he passed.
last and we follow him there. Over us sin no more has dominion, for in Christ more than conquerors we are. Turn your eyes upon Jesus, look full in his wonderful face, and the things of earth, they will grow strangely dim in the light, in the light, in the light of his glory and grace.
To the family and friends of Betty Rowe-Trammell, I can just offer this preamble to Paul's sweetest prayer in Philippians chapter 4, verse number 7. May the peace of God that passes all understanding guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Heavenly Father, Lord, we lift this family to you. And Lord, they can be in no better care. Lord, shower them with your love and with your grace. Provide for them perfectly as only you can do. Grace and strength and courage. And Father, we pray that you would strengthen their memory, and all of the wonderful moments that they've had with this wonderful saint of God will be refreshed, and they would carry them with them for the rest of their lives. And Lord, all of us who knew Betty Rowe-Trammell are grateful, are thankful for that experience. Thank you so much that you have blessed us and enriched us with such an incredible example of faithfulness as this wonderful woman. Lord, we love you and we thank you that you have answered all of our prayers for the healing of Betty Rowe-Trammell. She is well, and we thank you for that. In Jesus' name, amen.